This year, many of us have realised that we need our gardens more than ever. So every week on this series, I'm delighted to invite you to my home so that we can go gardening together. This one here. One great way to get new plants for your garden is to take cuttings. This is a salvia amistad, it's called. And you can take cuttings at very many times of the year. But at this time of the year, when the plant is young and vigorous and shooting up out of the ground, I'm able to take really lovely cuttings. All I've done is cut it down to about the size of a pencil. See these two leaves? Chop them in half so they won't lose that much water. Salvia is a large group of plants. This one will grow to about half a metre in height, and in about kind of 6 weeks, they should produce nicely rooted, fresh, young plants. Finally, what I'm going to do is water. Give them a nice drink to start them off. Those three cuttings will be really happy in this pot. They'll be happy being together. I'll put them on a sunny window ledge, and within 6 weeks, I should have three fine, well-rooted young plants for the garden. Now, many of you have been sending in questions by email, by video, through social media, and I'd love to answer some of the more unusual and some of the most common. Frida in County Armagh, please could you give me some advice on growing lavender in a container and where best to put the container? Most important thing you can think about, Frida, is where does lavender really love to grow? It's Mediterranean countries, isn't it? Sun-baked soil, often very poor soil. As long as it's in the sun and as long as you have free drainage. So in your pot, maybe make sure there's drainage holes in it, make sure the compost you use is maybe soil-based. You don't have to feed it, and put it in a very sunny position. If you do that, it'll be very happy. Now, this one from Michelle. Can you please advise on the best hardy ferns which are already established for large pots? This is a great question for Dara because he loves big architectural dramatic plants. Over to you, Dara.
You have to, at all times, work your own style into things and your own magic into the garden, and that's the best part about gardening is, you know, there's such a variety of plants, especially in Ireland, that we can grow. So ferns are a great choice for pots. They lend themselves really well to be grown in pots. If you were looking for something really big and showy, I'd maybe think about a Dicksonia if you were able to protect it in cold winters. But other than that, something like the Blechnum chilense is a brilliant one for pots, and we'll take a big pot as well. Sometimes gardens, we can grow so many things and have so many different styles and tastes and areas. It's all individuality, so it's bringing your own taste as well as others. And it takes everything. So it's sometimes coming out and having the quietness of a woodland or a river, and walking through such a busy estate can be really nice. A gardener can try his hardest, but nature and it'll always do it better.
For some of these questions, I think I need to take a closer look. It's time for some video calls. We often think of our gardens as places of peace, tranquility, and birdsong, but that's not always the case, is it, Fiona?
It's correct, Dermot. You can see the motorway is behind me here, and it is noisy, and I'd love your help for some advice on the best trees or plants to put here to screen that off.
You can use plants to do it. That's probably the best way. You can use things like evergreen laurels would do very well. Just keep them trimmed. Don't let them grow too wide into the garden. And the other thing is eucalyptus, a nice broadleaf tree would do very well in that situation. And you can cut it back every couple of years, produce new shoots with juvenile foliage. I think that may be very good for you.
Super, I should have made a list, Dermot.
You can watch it on the telly.
I can do.
Now, I've already redesigned some gardens in need of help, and this week we're heading to Kerry. Who's the best boy? Who's the best boy? So this next one is a little bit different. It is a guy called Shane who has a fine property, lots of land and gardens and plants, and he's really interested in pollinators and the environment, and he wants to do something good. And a virtual trip to Kerry is always good, isn't it, boy? Let's talk to Shane.
Hi, Diarmuid.
Hi, Shane. How are you?
I'm not too bad. How are you?
I'm good. I'm sitting here with the... Can you see the dog?
Very nice.
You're an avid gardener, Shane, aren't you?
I am, yeah. So I really got into it in the last 5 years.
So you have this house that has been restored?
Yeah, so my father purchased the house, Partnagira House, in the mid-90s and restored it to its former glory. It was built in 1840. And I suppose I haven't had anything traditional in the garden or something that's quite formal that fits with the architectural heritage of the house. So here in the corner of the stable yard, I've had this famin pot. It was a bit of an impulse buy, but I'm glad I bought it. It's not something that I've been able to move around. It's cast iron, very, very heavy, very solid. They were brought to Ireland by the Quakers during the Great Famine, and they were used to cook soup to feed to the poor. I knew that someday I'd use it as a garden feature. I'm finally looking forward to putting it somewhere and leaving it there and never having to try and lift it again. I'm a pig farmer and a cattle farmer. So I kind of got interested in gardening for wildlife. As a farmer, I understand the importance of pollinators because, you know, we need bees to pollinate a large percentage of the food that we eat. And it's important that we protect them, especially native bee species here in Ireland. So on the farms, you know, we plant native hedgerows, we plant native trees every winter for pollinators and for biodiversity. But I think it's also important that I do it in the garden as well.
OK, will you show me the space?
Yes. So as you can see here, I have all this large lawn area. And for me, it's too much lawn. I want to split it a bit, you know. I want to have a feature right in the middle that breaks up all this lawn area.
So it looks like you need planting and design. You need to bring this together. Mm-hmm. You want something that pays homage to the house, appreciates its location, and that is great for the birds, the bees, the butterflies.
Yeah, that's it exactly.
OK. That's great. I'll get scribbling away.
Thanks, Diarmuid.
Shane and Curry is after a, well, I suppose quite a grand garden to go with his period-style house. I garden in a much more relaxed way, I suppose, but I have the very man to help Shane out because Neil has been a consultant to private gardens and estates for decades.
I'm in the Italian garden here at Mount Stewart in County Down, a lovely formal garden in front of the house. This garden was one lady's dream. It was Edith, Lady Londonderry, who started the garden in 1917 during World War I. And she started to think about the plants for it as well, even at the same time. The formal garden has to have a boundary, it has to have a finite edge. Now, whether that's a wall or a low wall with piers or a hedge or a pergola, there has to be order. The idea of the formal garden is that you can make sense out of the chaos of nature. The geometry here, you know, you could fold it in half and it would be perfectly symmetrical. And it's lovely to have this geometry in the foreground of a beautiful scene, whether it be a seascape or far distant mountains. It helps you make sense of what you're looking at and makes the whole scene much more beautiful. This is my favourite plant in the garden, a lovely thing called Cantua buxifolia, the Peruvian magic tree, and it has long fuchsia-like flowers. It's a plant that Edith grew here in the 1920s, and we've been able to propagate it, and here it is flowering today. But really, these lovely Italianate gardens is all about architectural detail. The house will be the focal point. You'll be looking out from there, and possibly when you're going around the garden, looking back towards the house. And sometimes, if the architecture of the house is very strong, then the garden you're going to make, it can really just be a very basic geometric shape. Or if the architecture of your house is not so strong, maybe the real architectural element should come from the garden. And you have piers like we have here with dodos on top of them, or ponds with fountains. You've got to feel at home in a garden, so it has dignity and space and solitude, but it's also a friendly place in which to think, contemplate, a great place for the artist, the poet, the philosopher.
So Shane really has it all. He's a beautiful house, lovely location, a great interest in gardening. He has the manpower to have him out. I'd say he has a bit of a budget. I'm not going to design a small garden from. Let's just go for it. I could do with being a bit taller for this double-storey garden. There we go. What am I doing? I'm deadheading. I'm going around some plants in the garden, things like roses, and I'm taking the rose that is absolutely spent. If I don't, all the energy from the rose will go into producing rose hips, seeds that are useless to me. If I take them off, it'll encourage new blossom to come. You can do it not only with roses, but you do it with things like sweet pea, where you just pinch off, you don't need a second, just pinch off the spent flowers. It is something that you can get fairly obsessional about, but it's a good obsession. I'm definitely going to get this one. Repeat flowering plants should be deadheaded as soon as the blossom is over to encourage new flowers. Over the years, I've made some adaptions to the house and plenty of adaptions to the garden, but it's left me with some exterior architecture, brick, crittle windows, plastic coated doors and render. It doesn't all gel together. So as a final touch, I've come up with an idea. From here and all the way around, I'm going to clad this surface in what I might paint it, or, you know, nothing in my garden is new. The swing seats came from a garden we did at the Chelsea Flower Show, the spiral staircase from a salvage yard. When you're planning a garden, when you're planning any project, you need to use your imagination, not just for the creative stuff, but for the budget stuff too. Because they're sheltered, they'll wear very well, they'll weather very well. And I can paint them. I just think it's going to change everything here. Now, with a healthy budget, but only 4 weeks to complete the project, I'm excited to reveal my plan to Shane. So, Shane, I've got a copy of your garden plans here, but I know you have a copy there too. You turn over the paper.
Okay, wow.
I'm giving you a garden that belongs to the house. I'm enclosing a space behind a hedge, planting it with the most colourful species that will bring all that wildlife into the garden. I'm leaving some of the grass to go wild, so meadowgrass will grow in the middle of the lawn. And I've put gates down the end, and they lead into a kind of open courtyard. Okay. And that's where the famine pot would go. What do you think?
That's overwhelming, almost.
Overwhelming in a good way?
In a good way, in a good way.
Shane, normally with a job like this, it would be 4 to 5 months. You've got 4 weeks. But you have a reputation as a goer, a getter, a doer, okay, and a gardener.
So, do you think you can make it?
I think I'll give it a go, yeah, yeah.
It's a huge project. And to assist Shane, I'm sending my friend and project manager, James, to help him map out the site.
So we'll mark that right around. So we're at 1.4 metres. So right through the centre, you're going to get the view right down to where the famine pot is at the end of the garden.
So it's like leading the eye in.
Exactly.
Across.
Exactly. Okay. So if you hold on the centre of where the pot is, mm-hmm, we're going to mark this out. This is probably the biggest project and definitely the most ambitious. The biggest job here, now that we've measured it out, in my opinion, is the footpath.
Yeah.
If you can get that in immediately, you know, that's the first job you tackle. You have a lot to do. You have a lot to get on with.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. No pressure at all.
Will it happen?
Oh, yeah, it'll happen.
Good man. Yeah. Good man. Another sunny day, I met you up in the garden.
You were digging plants. I thought you beg your pardon. Who grows potatoes anymore? Well, we really should. They're the easiest and the most satisfying crop to grow. And you can grow them anywhere as long as you have a little bit of sunshine. Get a bucket, fill it with really good quality compost, about a third full. Then get some seed potatoes. These are sprouting nicely. These are first earlies, and I'm putting them in during midsummer. And planting them now means that I'll produce an amazing new crop of potatoes for Christmas dinner. Isn't that incredible? On top of that, I'm just going to spread some more of that compost. Another third of the container will be filled with this, and then I simply water. Those potatoes will begin to sprout and produce leaves within a week or so, and then just keep topping that pot up with fresh compost, keep watering them. And this is what you'll get. These were planted about 10 weeks ago. It's amazing how easy they are. And just imagine fresh spuds on your dinner plate for Christmas lunch. Now, we've all gone houseplant mad the last few years, and people love to fill their homes with foliage plants or flowers such as orchids. But did you know that once the weather warms up and the fear of frost is gone, from about, let's say, the middle of June, you can move your houseplants outside? They love being outside. If you are moving them out, put them in a shaded area, especially to start off with, because the sunlight, even in a covered space like this, would be much too strong for them. And the most important thing is that you'll have to remember to water them an awful lot more regularly. But if you can, use rainwater. There's no chemicals in that, and they'll absolutely adore it. Give everything a good drenching. And when they've acclimatized to being outside for a little while, I can move some of them to brighter places. So we all enjoy a holiday, but your houseplants will also have a holiday outdoors during the summer months. In the dictionary, topiary is defined as the art of clipping trees and shrubs into ornamental shapes. For me, it's much more fun than that. This is a bay tree. It's been clipped into a conical shape, and I used it in a garden at the Chelsea Flower Show a number of years ago. Every year now, I come out in midsummer and I try to refine that original shape by very carefully going around the plant and trimming off new growth. I choose a dull kind of overcast day because in very bright sunny weather there would be a chance of burning some of the leaves. And when it's nicely shaped, I'm going to give this plant a good feed, a mulch of well-rotted farmyard manure and a watering, because this will put it under some stress, so we'll be nice to it. Topiary in this garden does a great job. They were leftover plants, but they form some pillars, just, I have six of them. They're evergreen also, so in the middle of winter, I have some good interest here. Cutting it keeps it in shape, but it also encourages new growth, which will help to thicken it up. Now, Edward Scissorhands, eat your heart out. So I've had the chickens a month now, and it's been nothing but pure joy. You really get very, very fond of them. They're my girls. They're coming out for breakfast now. Here's the ladies. Morning, ladies. And I've learned that you should really get to know them, let them know you, know your voice, so they begin to follow you around. Every evening, I let them out in the garden. I'm not sure how good, they're doing brilliant for bugs and slugs and stuff like that, but I'm not sure how good they're doing for the plants. Mary Lou, you're getting left out. That's not like you. You're getting the drips from the table. Arlene and Michelle are going at it. Look at this, full bowl there, but they prefer to take it from my hand. And do you know, they're great layers. I get 3 eggs a day. So all of a sudden, we've become a very popular family. So much so that we had to buy half a dozen eggs yesterday. We'd given away so many. While they're having breakfast, I'm going to show you what I've been at underneath the veranda. Remember, the issue here was that the back of the house was fairly bland. There was some brickwork, there was rendered concrete, and I wanted to link it all together and brighten it up. Now, I've chosen an ice cream shade of pink, I suppose. It's fairly out there. However, when the evening light hits that, it's absolutely brilliant. It dances, and it makes you feel like you're in Key West. This is a mix of styles, though. I've developed this garden with architectural salvage, the pillars, and I've brought in a few kind of Victorian, I suppose, features with a couple of lamps and oversized pots with a lot of shade-loving planting. So we're picking up on the pink theme at this time of the year with the stilbies and lots of ferns. If we come around a corner here, we see another piece of salvage. This is a Victorian plant stand. And the idea here is anything that's looking really good in the garden from the terrace area, I put it in a pot, bring it up here, so I don't have to wander through the garden to see what's looking good. More of the big pots. This is a lovely indoor plant, a philodendron, which loves being outside on its holidays, and a nice carex underneath it. Opposite me is the bar, which is an old balcony. And beyond the bar, one of my favourite parts of the veranda is just this area here with the swing seats. Later in the day, the sun streams in here. It's a beautiful place to while away a couple of hours. Another man on a mission with his traditional garden to build is Shane in Kerry. I gave him just 4 weeks to undertake a huge project. Has he succeeded? I can't wait to see what he's done. This is a big one, very elegant design, beautiful house. I've brought him some presents, lovely tree and some perennials. But I think the surprise is for me.
been quite overwhelming, but very lucky to have the friends who helped me, because without them I couldn't have done it. The weather was a massive challenge, full on rain, but we got there in the end.
A traditional garden takes years to establish, but Shane has made an amazing start.
The planting scheme works so well, the design, everything just is, it's perfect. Really, really is. I'm very happy. The famine pot finally has a home. You know, it had been here the last couple of years and I wanted to do something with it, and now it's finally there, so I'm hoping it'll stay there for another 180 years.
I presume that's Shane, is it?
Hello.
Hey!
A tree!
Yeah, this is a sericidophyllum.
Brilliant.
Congratulations.
Thank
Look
you.
Look at that. It fits really well in with the original garden. The pot, which you want, it gets its prominence.
It does.
It's beautifully framed in those two arches. And this is the area that you're going to let grow.
Yeah,
what you, of all people, know how important it is to encourage pollinators.
Yeah. Like, we've so many different habitats on the farm, and I think that this is just another habitat, basically.
And look at the plants.
Yeah.
The sedums, the butterfly bush. They're great, aren't they?
They work so well. And what I love about it is that whenever I'm going to be out here, whether it's a frosty winter morning or a summer's day, there's always going to be something that's going to be in flower that will be capturing my attention.
What are your favourite plants?
At the moment, you know, the bog sage is just about to come out into flower. That looks amazing.
Great.
And of course, it's very suited to the wet conditions here.
Yeah, I'd love that one.
Yeah.
Asters are looking
look
well,
great.
Lots of colour, and again, lots of bees will be buzzing around. How's the pigs?
They're good. Yeah, I haven't seen them now in a few days, unfortunately. I've been very busy.
Are they gardeners?
No, they're not.
I bet they're good rotavators.
They are.
They would have been the thing to set into the ground.
I should have used a few pigs instead of hiring a rotavator.
Lovely. It's been great to garden together with you,
Shane. It's been fantastic. It was hard work, stressful, but, you know, we got there in the end.
Well, from now on, your garden will be a stress relief.
That's for sure.
And now it's become a garden that Shane's whole family can enjoy.
They complement each other, what he has put in there, you know. The colours are going to be fabulous. And the fact that he can see it from his conservatory, you know, he can look out and admire it, you know, when he's having his cup of tea or whatever. I will come down more often now, I think, and relax and enjoy it.